Okay, great. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for having me. So we've talked about health, crowdsourcing, sustainability. This is a little bit about economics. It's very, very new work. I just started working in this area. So before I start, I just want to say that there's two points I largely want to make. One is sort of what Sudhindra started out with, that there's a great need to actually put data into some common place where ordinary people can access it. Because otherwise, when you talk about economics, right, so things like key indicators, it's very hard to get any of that data to be able to visualize it, and that really impacts the understanding. Because otherwise, there's a lot of myths that start getting propagated, right, about whether the Gujarat model is better for development or the Kerala model and so on. And right, so that data is quite important. And we're sitting on a big opportunity because now with so many big data sources like satellite data becoming available, text analytics, social media, so there's many, many interesting things that can be done to be able to improve and look at a way to monitor the economy. And the second part is that this data is actually will not be enough. So there's a big reason to actually use actual crowdsourced data through, so I call them participatory media networks, which is where users participate to create content. So I have a company, Gramvani, that I've been running for several years now, which I'll start talking about, and that is working in the rural context of empowering people to be able to create their own media and talk about it, discuss it with others. And that's actually very important because it gives you the capability to very quickly run like rapid population surveys with the population to get insights, which can explain some of the observations you might be making from large economic, macroeconomic, big data sets. So very, very quickly, the way some of our platforms work is we use IVR systems because we're working with low literacy users, and it's interactive, so people can call, they can listen to content, and they can contribute their own content in voice. So basically, they can record something, which then can be heard by other people. And we're not the only ones doing it. Bill's been working with CGNet, very, very pioneering work. And there's many other initiatives like Avaaz Day and several others who have used this model of IVR systems to basically generate content right from the mouth of the people, so literally, right? And right, just something, but however, we also realized was that it wasn't simple to get this working, because when we're working with low literacy users, one of the biggest challenges is that how do we drive technology adoption itself? And that's where it needs to be coupled with an offline model where we actually have people on the ground, volunteers with whom we've built some very interesting incentive mechanisms so that they can train people, educate them about using technology platforms and get them to start contributing content. Similarly, the very interesting process is that how do you actually motivate people to contribute interesting, relevant insights, which otherwise you'll not be able to get, right? So I won't talk too much about that, but there's lots of interesting work in terms of how do we train volunteers, how do we build editorial processes, and actually how does this lead to impact in terms of bringing, sort of like what Sunita was saying, right, bringing people together for collective action, and a lot of offline work that needs to enable to be able to do that, to hold public institutions accountable, private providers accountable. Similarly, how it leads to awareness and behavior change. Right, so we've been doing all of this work, and one of the good things is that it's really helped us. We've been working in about 20 districts for several years now, and it's built a very, very strong trust and bond between the community and our platform. And that then becomes very important because we're able to get a lot of interesting data. So like when demonetization happened, we were able to run a very, very quick survey, right? That how did it affect the wages and other things of like wage workers or local traders and businessmen. We were able to run like polls very quickly that even despite all that, like 64% said that, yeah, it's a great thing. We can do things like longitudinal tracking, right? Which otherwise, when government does family health surveys or censuses, right? The time gap is very long. It's like five years, or censuses happen every 10 years. But through some of these platforms, we can get very, very quick insights. So on things like nutrition, we're doing some projects on nutrition where we were able to track, right, awareness of people on diversity of food or adequacy and frequency and whether they know about these things. And similarly, a lot of very interesting new information comes out. So for example, we've doing something on dowry and early marriage. And so this is like a story waiting for a journalist to pick up, literally, that people are talking about a marriage corridor which has been set up between Bihar to Uttar Pradesh, which is another state, that low-income families are not able to afford dowry. Their daughters end up getting married in a certain pocket. And then other things which are not covered in mass media. So this is something which happened recently that because of Dhanbad is an area which has a lot of coal mines. And a particular stretch of a railway line was recently decommissioned because there were underground fires and it was a safety hazard. A lot of folks then, these views, like counter views, which none of the media actually covered, that just blocking of the railway was not the best thing to do. I mean, it was important for safety, but actually the company had to be held accountable and nothing actually happened on some of those fronts. So these things are able to we're able to get this data largely because of the trust that's been established. And so some ways in which, I'll just talk about some use cases. So we've been trying to do things like detect hoarding in agricultural commodities, where traders can create a short-term supply shortage by holding back grains, which then increases the price and then they make money in the process, right? So what we actually realize that we've been trying to do this for some time, but what we're now realizing is that we can't do this just by using data on commodity prices and arrivals, which is available. But rather, we actually need sort of like whistleblowers, or we need to actually survey smallholder farmers. Only then can we actually detect that there's been hoarding. So for example, we saw that there was in a particular year, there was unseasonal rain, which basically destroyed the crop. And that gets reflected in the data that the arrivals dropped in that particular year, right? But then what was interesting was that in the next season, when the next harvest was about to come, the harvest did not hit the market, right? But the hoarders, the traders basically held back the grain, and that the kind of price hike it created was something like this, right? Prices were like almost five times what they otherwise are. A very similar thing happened in 2013, right, and other things, right? But now in all of these, the point is that just by looking at the data, you can't actually detect that there's been this kind of a hoarding which is happening. Rather, you need ways to get down to the people and be able to collect some of this, where trust and incentives and a lot of that collective action required to get some of this information becomes quite important. Another interesting way that we've been trying to do is looking at using satellite data. So folks, you might be familiar, right? There's been a lot of research in terms of using night lights, which is the intensity of lighting observed during the night, and which very nicely has been shown to correlate with GDP. So even in India, we see something similar that the GDP movements are very seasonal. So the quarter three of the financial year, which is also the Diwali time post-harvest, the lights are the brightest, and then it sort of goes up and down. And that very nicely correlates with the night lights. And similarly, if you look at, so while GDP data comes out every quarter and then it gets revised, but data at the district level, so if you want to monitor the economic activity at the district level, that's very difficult, right? But with night lights, you can actually see a substantial difference that Dhanbad, which has coal mines and like heavy industry, the lighting profile of villages looks very different from a place in Tamil Nadu, Dindigul, which has a lot of garment and spinning mills, which is very different from agriculture, right? Because over here you have much, much brighter areas. And some of this also correlates, like with census data, we know that from 2011, right, Dhanbad had, in census, they look at roof type, that if the roof type is very traditional, that's normally associated with low income. And you can see that changing, that as you go down from Dhanbad to Nasik, there's a shift in terms of using rudimentary and traditional roofs, right? So satellite data and these sort of big data can really help supplement whatever economic data is being collected, because otherwise censuses and surveys are not able to get down to that level of granularity. Plus this data is available, night lights, you can get it on a monthly basis, right? So you can do very, very high frequency sort of updates on what's happening at the local level. Oddly enough, of course, so this is a classic growth versus development debate, right? So if you instead look at households, percentage of households with treated water, Dhanbad fares very badly as compared to Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu, right? Where percentage of households which have clean drinking water is much, much higher, right? So there's a classic thing that even though lights are brighter, maybe there's higher income. We're trying to get income data also, right? But development indexes are quite low. So these are basically some of the points which become important, that if there is a way in which people can visualize all this data more easily, then they can also compare, right? That how is industrialization driven development different from, let's say, welfare funded programs, right? Because these are like very, very hot topics of debate, right? With the governments and especially this current dispensation looking at cutting out social welfare schemes and everything, right? And so that's the kind of very large myth that gets created about different sorts of neoliberal kind of models going out, right? So very similarly, so when demonetization happened, right, Q3 normally has been always the highest, but you can very easily see that Q3 was, and the same thing got reflected over here. So we've similarly, you know, you can look at disruptions in seasonal patterns to kind of detect anomalies that might be happening, right? And then look at other crowdsourced data to figure out why is this an anomaly. Right, so we've just started looking at some of this, but we're definitely able to see demonetization effects and different things. Then researchers have also seen that election affects nightlife, because what happens is that before the election date, a couple of months before that, the state government, especially in constituencies where there is competition, they divert electricity so that people are happier and they'll sort of vote for the government in power. Right, so over here there was a flip, and we see that in Dindigul the seasonal pattern got disrupted, more lights were given, but even then the other party won, right? But in Dhanbad, for example, right, nothing happened. Here also nothing happened, because the same government, I mean, they're pretty confident that we'll get through, so they said, yeah, why bother, let's look at the places where there's more competition, right? So we've state election kind of has a different kind of pattern. We are trying to look at it in more scale, right, by looking at different districts and stuff. Right, so again, the point, larger point is that there's a lot of interesting things that you can do with big data, but which need to be supplemented with voices of the people, right, as to what's actually happening on the ground, right? And right, so another sort of small example is where this rural unemployment, right, people are moving to the cities, but at the same time, you know, and this data of this sort, that productivity has grown, but labor wages of wage workers is still flat, right? So these are real wages indexed to inflation, but nothing's changed really. And that leads to these things that, well, people are not able to do much and go back, right? So I'll just quickly come here, right? So broadly, I mean, the main goals that we're trying to do with this whole thing, it's sort of a larger, longer term vision. Right, but basically provide data, maybe build automatic alert systems in this data which can put out anomalies, supplement it with real data coming from the people, right, so that there's a much more complete picture that people can see of how the economy is doing, and basically build up the literacy in, like, economy literacy about how the economy works, so that they can then ask better questions, right questions, hold. Right, and politics is, of course, probably the only tool that is there, but right, so use that in proper ways. Yeah, so I'll stop here. Thanks.
Any quick questions?
Yes. Two questions.
So yeah, wonderful presentation. So thanks very much. Specific question I have is this mobile money, for example, right? Yeah. What is in it for the user? Why are they participating? Right? How do you incentivize them to contribute data? And
yeah, no, so well, many people, there's different reasons for different people. Like, I mean, one thing is that the areas where we're working are really media dark. So like TV penetration is like 20-25%. So this becomes the only media that they have. And it's like on-demand media, which they can call in and listen. So there's that aspect. But then the other is also a lot of social credibility, right? Because they see that it's not just a media, like a regional news media as such, but what I didn't talk about so much is that people share problems that they're facing with government schemes, and the volunteers we have on the ground, they help solve many of these problems for the people. So there's a very strong, I mean, they associate impact with the media, which is theoretically the role that a media should serve, but unfortunately, I mean, mass and regional media don't do that much these days.
Yeah. question.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So I've got two questions.
Yeah.
So a lot of recent experience has been that crowd generated news is a terrible idea. It actually leads to all kinds of bias and so on. So I'm curious how your system avoids that. That's one question. Regarding the second part where you showed interesting graphs of, you know, level of lighting and so on, have you actually tried to make any predictions based on blind data and verify that your predictions actually?
Yeah, well, so we haven't got as far as a prediction. This is very, very recent work. Like, I mean, we started this whole satellite thing two, three months back, so it's very recent. But in terms of the news, right, so over there, I think one of the biggest things, we try to check whatever we can, because we also have volunteers and which are like feet on the street, so they can verify anything which seems dubious. But more than that, I think it's the nature of the medium, right? So if you build a medium which is doing good things for the community, and you're filtering out junk, you're putting out good information out there, then people naturally start respecting that medium. So of course, I mean, we may also miss out on users, but ultimately if people respect, then, I mean, it leads to like proper, credible information coming out. So that's also something important. I think, I mean, the nature of the medium and trust and everything, those become very important.
Thank you.